Employers are needed to hire women on the pre-prison release program. For more information, call 894-4881.
I thought he's a little one.
I really did, too. I brought him all the way to here to the boat.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
I bet that's 3 or 4 fish that size that have hit me, and I thought they're little old 3/4-pound fish.
You know, fishing and the outdoors is something that everyone can enjoy. And for full family entertainment, Jerry McKinnis invites you to come along on another visit to the Fishin' Hole. The Fishin' Hole is brought to you by this fine family of sponsors. Eagle Claw, the most famous name in fishing. By Mercury Outboards, your best investment in a fishing engine, 4 to 20 horsepower. By Ranger, the bass boat designed by fishermen for fishermen. By Steel, the world's largest selling chainsaw. And by Holiday Inn. Holiday Inn welcomes you to the best hotels in the world.
Since the dawn of time, men have sought reliable tools to do simple chores, and among the first was the fish hook. But it was this century before the perfect hook was achieved. This original Eagle Claw design copies the eagle's talon to give you the most nearly perfect hook for every style of fishing. Today, there are more than 1,200 types and sizes of American-made Eagle Claw hooks for fly fishing in fast-rushing streams, spinning in a quiet pond, plugging deep reservoirs, or surf casting a favorite beach. Each Eagle Claw hook is precision engineered and scientifically tempered for maximum strength and sharpness. They're available in reusable boxes and easy to use nylon snells in convenient packs you carry in a shirt pocket. Every hook is made in America to the half century old reputation for quality, which made Eagle Claw the best known name in all fishing.
You're about to be welcomed to one of the best hotels in the world. The hotels with the best locations. Near the things you want to be near. The hotels with the best system of standards for comfort and taking care of you.
Look at that pool.
The hotels that take care of more travelers than anybody else. Holiday Inn welcomes you to some of the best hotels in the world.
Say, it's been almost 2 or 3 weeks now since we've done any smallmouth bass fishing, and this is Jerry McKinnis, and you know how I love to fish for smallmouth bass. Say, we're glad you showed up this week for the Fishin' Hole, because we are going for a few more smallmouth this week, and you remember that here a while back we were up fishing in the Quetico National Forest. And boy, we had such good fishing, such a good trip, so many things happening that we really couldn't get it all in on one show. And so I thought I'd take a little time and venture back up there again and show you the rest of that wonderful bass fishing trip. I am fortunate to get to fish for these smallmouths 2 weeks out of a season. I usually don't get but about 1 week a year of this kind of fishing. This was the best smallmouth fishing I've ever had in my life. And it's a trip that I can just practically guarantee you that you'll maybe not have this kind of luck, even have a little bit better luck. I don't know. But I can guarantee you that you can catch yourself a lot of real nice fish. And I'm going to spend some time today explaining exactly how we made that trip and how you might be able to turn around and make the same trip this summer. Because I know that if you're a bass fisherman, if you're any kind of a fisherman, especially a smallmouth fisherman, you want to get up to this place and do a little fishing. Now, you're watching right here as we boat one of several fish from 4 to 6 pounds. Most of the smallmouth we caught were naturally from about 2 pounds to 4 pounds, but we did have enough fish above 4 pounds to make it awful doggone interesting. And you know that, gosh, there's a lot of people who fish all their life for 1, 4, 5 pound smallmouth. They're really a pleasure to catch. And the gentleman in the back of the boat with me is Harry Lambrith. And Harry was really the outfitter for me. Harry's an old friend of mine. And he and his wife took us into this lake that, and I'm going to explain exactly how we get there in just a second here, but I wanted to point out that Harry was really the secret to our success, because he put us right into... I had fished the Quetico Forest Park Forest before and had good fishing, but I'd never had any quite like this. And I'm going to start right back from the beginning on really an old cloudy, nasty, cool day when we started out of Ely, Minnesota, and we put in on Moose Lake. Now, you can get a map of Minnesota and find a lot of these places that I'm going to tell you about. But we put in on Moose Lake right out of Ely, Minnesota. Here he's got a little cabin where he lives right out very close to this lake. As you can see, we piggybacked our canoes up Moose Lake, and along the border of Minnesota and Canada lay three or four big lakes, Lac La Croix, Crooked Lake, Knife Lake, and these are the lakes that you go to. These are the lakes we went to from Moose Lake, and this is where we crossed crossed the border from Moose Lake. After we had piggybacked the boats up to the portage, we moved them for about a mile on a little trailer and then went into the ranger station. You have to go through the ranger station, get your fishing license, your permits, get everything all checked out to go into this park. Now, they're very particular about this park. They make sure that everything is really kept clean and on the up and up, and they take awful good care of it. Now, from that point where we came out of Moose Lake, on the United States side of the big lakes, all size motors were allowed. On the Canadian side of the lake, only small engines were allowed. And then after we got so far and portaged out of the big lakes into some smaller lakes, no motors at all were allowed. Now, I want to bring up the fact that there was some discussion during the winter and during the spring about changing some of these motor regulations. How they're going to change them, I really don't know. There was a lot of controversy on it, as a matter of fact. But at this point, that was how things were. And then we portaged, and you can see even the dog Remus is going to do a little portaging right here. Everybody has to pitch in on these portages, and we didn't have too many to make, and that was fortunate, because they're a lot of fun when you make two or three of them. When you start making lots of them, they start getting into a lot of work. Then naturally, we don't want to spend any of our fishing time working too hard. Good night almighty. See, I've got my two boys up there, Mark and Mike. This fishing trip was made about a week before school started last fall. That'll give you an idea of the time of the year we were up there, sometime in September. I think the fishing starts up there generally about the middle of June, and I very seldom, you know, when we make some film or make a trip in the fall at a certain place, I don't really intend to go back there right away. You know, there's so many places to cover that to make them all, you can't double back very often. But I fully intend to go back up into this area this coming summer, not necessarily to shoot film, but to just go up there and fish. As you could plainly see there, we finally portaged our way into an area where we wanted to fish, and we made a lot of portages and a lot of moves that you didn't see. We made a portage down the falls there at Crooked Lake, moved into some small lakes off of, or a small lake off of Crooked Lake. And if you take yourself a map and look at the area that I'm talking about, you can see that there's just literally dozens and dozens of small lakes, some of them connected by little streams which have fish in them. Some of them don't. Some of the streams don't have. Most all of the lakes have some fish in them. Many of the lakes, Harry hasn't even fished yet, and Harry lives right there and does the guiding and the outfitting as a living, and hasn't had time to fish all the lakes. So you get the idea. There's lots of places to fish up there. There's many of these lakes have names. You'll see them right on there. There's Darkey Lake. I fished Darkey Lake. not on this trip, but we fished it before. It's awful good fishing. South Bay, North Bay, Sunday Bay, so on, so on. There's all kinds of little small lakes up there. Many of them don't even have a name. And all of them have, no, I shouldn't say all of them have smallmouth in them. Most of them have a smallmouth in them. Some of them you have to work awful hard to get to. Naturally, I guess the harder you work at it, the better the fishing's going to be. But we have portaged into this small lake without a name off of Crooked Lake. And the first evening here, we're going to stay right here and fish this particular lake. It took us all day to get into the area. We had in spite of the kind of the cloudy, windy weather, we had a big time getting there. And we set up our camp, and the day straightened out a little bit, and at least we're going to have a pretty evening. And the prospects for the next couple of days was really great, and we did. We had two or three beautiful days after we got done. And, you know, it's a funny thing. When we got ready to go back home, the weather got bad again, and it was bad all the way back to Moose Lake and Harry's cabin. That's kind of unusual, isn't it? Usually it's bad while you're fishing, and it's good while you're traveling. we must have been doing things just right, because we had some beautiful, beautiful weather. This little lake that we're fishing here is, you can see it. That's it right there. It's a little bit bigger to the left and to the right of what you're looking at, but for the most part, you're seeing all the fishing, and we're going to be back to see if we can't get into some more real nice smallmouth after this message.
Well, folks, I'm Jerry Reed. I make my living playing the guitar, but really I should fish for a living, because probably I am the greatest fisherman who ever lived. Seriously, though, folks, choosing a fishing partner is important, and these Fish Power Beauties 4 to 20 horsepower make perfect fishing partners. Fast starts? Yep. Thunderbolt solid-state electronic ignition takes care of that. Economy? Yes, indeed. Fixed jet carburetors squeeze the miles out of every gallon. Quiet? You got it. Jet prop exhaust buries the sound underwater behind the boat. Now, to keep you fishing and not fretting, this little rubber safety hub here gives when you hit a log or rock, and you keep right on trucking. So you never have to change a shear pin, because there ain't one. Folks, this beauty has shallow water drive, glide angle design lower unit, fish line cutter, and troll set so you can fish easy, brother. Go see your Merc dealer, and he'll fill you in on all the other features that make Merc your perfect fishing partner. Oh, look at that.
If you remember the last bit of film we had on the Quetico Park, the boys were doing a lot of fishing off the bank. Well, Harry Lambrith and I didn't do much fishing off the bank, but it was amazing to me how at certain parts of the lakes you could walk out on the limbs like we're walking out on right now and look up and down the bank at the smallmouth. I'd never seen anything like it before. And whereas when this does happen sometimes on other lakes, most of the fish are small, these were big fish. We would look down there in the water and see smallmouth anywhere from 2 to 5 pounds just swimming around in the bushes, just acting like they had good sense, you know. Beautiful sight. Oh, my goodness. And the best thing about it was the fact that they would bite, too. Gosh, I've been to lots of lakes where I could see fish swimming around, but the best thing about these was they were very anxious to cooperate and jump on those little jigs we were fishing with. And we were fishing, doing all of our fishing with little small plastic grubs and small plastic twister-type baits, little plastic worms, and very small bucktail jigs. With as much fishing as I do, people kind of expect me to know something about equipment. Somebody's always asking me, what do you use to get the big ones with? Well, the answer is simple. It's the oldest name in the business. It's what all the pros use. It's lightweight, it's dependable, it's priced right, and it feels right in my hand, too. It's a Steel, world's largest selling chainsaw. And when it comes to getting the big ones or the small ones, Steel chainsaws are the only ones to use.
The search through space and time for materials that can withstand harsh environments and designs of fail-safe reliability has made possible Eagle Claw skirted spool spinning reels with an internal automatic bail system. Five sizes let you match your reel and your fishing to anything from ultralight to big saltwater action. Skirted spool reels in the highest tradition of Eagle Claw quality. The reputation is the difference. Eagle Claw.
Say we're having some mighty fine fishing today, and I've been trying to cram in as much information on how you might make this trip and the general area and just all that kind of stuff today. Just been putting as much of that in as I possibly could. Let me say what I generally say about every trip. If perchance you want to make it, I think the best thing to do would be to just drop me a card or a letter or give me a call, and I'll try to get you in contact with the right people. I think that's just about the most simple way. What a pretty little lake. And the fisherman in the front of my boat is my oldest boy, Mark. And old Mike in the red plaid shirt shows up every now and then. He's over in the boat with Harry. And Harry and I did a little bit of fishing together. Harry's wife, Mary, was along with us, and she did a lot of the cooking and cleaning up, but she also got in a lot of fishing too. And boy, what a great outdoor gal she is. She was a dandy. Her and Harry both are just really the perfect outdoor people. Boy, they live in a little old log cabin up there in Ely, and make it through those hard old winters up there somehow. Matter of fact, Harry, I think, traps during the winter time, and then they fish and guide in the summertime. Just a delightful couple. Now, all these fish are coming out of real shallow water, and whereas most of the stuff you're looking at is shot in the evening, the fishing was good all day long. Boy, we'd get up early in the morning, well, whenever we wanted to get up, and go out and catch a bunch of fish for breakfast, or catch a few fish until breakfast and come in and eat and go back out right in the middle of the daytime. I don't care how still that water was or how high that sun was, the fish were still very active. And of course, this is a case of fish that aren't being bothered too much. You can generally catch them any time of the day. And there's lots of people that go through this park, but they're mostly canoers. Ooh, Mark lost a good one right there, didn't he? Oh, he thought he had that thing all wrapped up. He's going to tell us what happened now. Well, we've seen it, Mark. You just messed up and lost the fish, let's face it. Now, most of the people that come through here are canoers, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, groups of kids doing nothing but canoeing. They fish a little bit, you know, but just not very much. They camp at night and then pick up the next morning and keep right on canoeing. And what a wonderful trip, huh? When you get right down to it, a terrific experience for a bunch of kids. But boy, we like to stop every now and then, throw those little baits around. This is fishy water. Now, some of these lakes have got northern in them. A lot of them have got lots and lots of walleye in them. Some of the deeper lakes up there, naturally, have some lake trout in them. So they've got some variety up there if you're not that interested in the smallmouth fishing. But today, at least as far as I can tell, there's not many places you can go where you feel like you're in the wilderness, unless you just really pack up and go to the Yukon or someplace like some far out place like that, you know, way north in Canada. But right here is some areas on the border, on the Minnesota border, and I guarantee you can get up there and really feel like you're lost, really feel like you are away from it all, and you will be too. You're just flat in the wilderness. That's all there is to it. And sometimes we get to thinking, I know I'm guilty of it myself, sometimes I get to thinking that the South has got the smallmouth bass fishing locked up. Good night. There's some good smallmouth fishing in Wisconsin and Minnesota. Matter of fact, there's some darn good smallmouth fishing over in Washington and California and over in the Northeast in Maine and Vermont. Boy, they've got some super smallmouth fishing. And I don't think it's bothered as much. And I think that this fishing right here is this good because it's not bothered as much. And I told you that I had been up here fishing before. Mike's caught him a few fish this morning, and as you can tell, we're turning loose lots of fish, but we also kept lots of fish, too, because that's about all we ate while we was up there. Oh, we had some other meals, too, naturally, but we ate lots of fish because, boy, they were good. They were just really good. And we'd take the fish that we would catch on a stringer and put them in a little live box that we made along the bank there, and then when we got all done, we turned them loose. So there's still lots of fish up there. Matter of fact, I think these lakes have got too many fish in it, just to be quite honest with you. No, I started to tell you that I had fished in this park before, and it was maybe 6 or 8 years ago, which is a pretty good stretch. And when I left it at that point, I thought, boy, I'll bet you if I come back here in a few years, it'll be crowded and some of the wilderness feeling will be gone from the Quetico Park. But there I am again, right out there very recently, and it's just as wild as it ever was. Really proud of that area. I'm certainly proud that I was able to take my kids up there and get them into some of this fishing and in some of this country. More than the fishing, I'm glad they got to see this kind of country. Old Mr. Smallmouth Bass is a real fighter. I guess that's the reason that I talk about him so much, and I'm not the only one that's guilty of that. Anytime you get around some fishermen who know much about it at all, start talking to them about the fish, in their top two or three fish, a smallmouth will wedge his way in there some way. And I was telling somebody not long ago that I think one of the biggest reasons I like to catch smallmouth is because they're so beautiful. And when you take them out of the water, they just still seem like they're mad. They just curl their body up and spread their fins out. And Mark has got a nice smallmouth on here, incidentally. And this is good. Well, you're going to have a perfect illustration of what I'm talking about. When he takes this fish out of the water, first of all, look how beautiful it is. Look at the markings of it and just beautiful. That's all there is to it. And then watch how he curls his body up and spreads out his fins and really looks aggravated about the whole thing. What are you guys doing up here in this boat messing around in my pond? By gosh, I was out there on the end of them rocks catching crawfish. Wasn't looking for any kind of trouble. Now watch him. Watch him curl up. They'll always do it. A smallmouth, and watch his tail. See there? He's ready to go, isn't he? What do you mean? Fooling with me for breakfast time here. Boy, we had this little rock out there in the middle of the lake, or the little island, rather, and I'd put my foot out there on the bank, like you can see me doing right there, and hold the canoe there, and we'd just throw out on the end of those rocks and bump those little jigs and little plastic worms and what have you off the end of those rocks, and it was just really something. They don't tell how many fish was down there. It's kind of neat, too, because there's not going to be many fish ever taken out of here because you can't get them out. There's no way. You know, you can't go up there with ice boxes where you can put fish on ice because you don't want to lug in a big ice box full of ice. It's just too heavy. So when you come right down to it, the only fish that are taken out of these lakes are the fish that you eat. And I say again, there's probably not enough fish taken out of them. Although it doesn't seem to be hurting this lake any. Whatever's going right or whatever's going wrong, we need to find out the situation, because this lake seems to be doing right. All these banks were full of these big boulders like this. Everywhere you can look in the water, and you could look on. I imagine Mike's boat sitting in, well, he might be in 6 foot of water right out there, but you could look about anywhere you wanted to and see the bottom of that lake. It was really something. Beautiful fishing. Of course, we're fishing with 4-pound test line, just as light as line as we can, and I'm sure that did help us catch a few extra fish. You saw us setting up our tent up there on the bank, and we had all of our duds. Now, we had sleeping bags and tents and all of our cooking utensils and a canopy top to stretch over the campfire in case it come up a shower, and boy, just everything we needed, we had, and it was pretty neat. Of course, we'd move from lake to lake, and you'd have to break it down and move on, but it didn't take very long. Didn't take very long with that many kids around to help and everybody pitching in. Wasn't much to it. Mike says, "What did you all slip up on me for when I caught little old small fish?" You know Mike, he's a fishing dude, and he caught some dandy smallmouth while we were there. And again, I say we took some fish in, and we put them in this live well that you're going to be looking at right here. And when we got ready to move to another lake or got ready to go home, the fish that we didn't want, we'd take and turn them loose. Look how clear that water is. Look at that. Isn't that something? You talk about some good fishing. And you talk about getting your fishing fever up. Now, I'm ready to go. My little old rod and reel is just ready to hit it. The fishing starts up there again in June. Matter of fact, I understand that's even better than what it is right now. I can't believe that. But that's what Harry says. And he told me about this lake and how good fishing was, and I always thought he was full of a lot of fishing stories. But boy, he proved himself right, so maybe he proved himself right about June, too. But anyhow, it starts about June and is real good. Catch a lot of fish up there on topwater baits, and then, of course, we did our fishing in the fall. The Quetico Superior Forest, right on the Minnesota line. You get you out a map and you take a look at it. Some great fishing.
In the heart of the Ozarks, small, proud communities reflect the image of rural America, where people take a lot of pride in what they do. Flippin, Arkansas, population 1,026, is a typical small town where good old Ozark know-how has gained national recognition. Years ago, a native son of Flippin, who already was known nationally as one of the country's finest fishermen, designed and built his first bass boat in a garage in downtown Flippin. The man was Forrest Wood, who had a better idea. For Forrest barely finished the boat when a friend bought it. So Forrest built another, and another, and another. And they call them Ranger boats. And today, Ranger boats are still built 100% by hand by proud Ozark folks who, along with Forrest Wood, want each step in the design and construction to be perfect. And that's why they not only build a better fishing boat, but have helped establish a standard for worksmanship and safety in boating. See your Ranger dealer, and you'll know why.
Mercury Quicksilver Accessories, folks you can depend on. Your Merc dealer has a wide selection of props for every boat need, including the tough stainless steel, Mercury Quicksilver oil that lubricates and protects your engine, controls, instruments, and a line of service aids that keep your engine looking pretty and a running pretty. Folks, your Mercury dealer's got just about every accessory you need to keep you out on the water, whether you're fishing for luck or skiing for pleasure or just cruising for fun. So sign and go see him.
The Fishin Hole with Jerry McKinnis was brought to you by this fine family of sponsors. Eagle Claw, the most famous name in fishing. By Mercury Outboards, your best investment in a fishing engine, 4 to 20 horsepower. By Ranger, the bass boat designed by fishermen for fishermen. By Steel, the world's largest selling chainsaw. And by Holiday Inn. Holiday Inn welcomes you to the best hotels in the world.
This is the Jensen Flipper Shrimp, which is excellent for fresh and saltwater fishing. The Flipper Shrimp is truly unique because it has live action built in its vibrating tail. It's available in 13 beautiful fluorescent colors, and it's designed for rod and cane pole fishing. The Flipper Shrimp is an exact reproduction of a real live shrimp. Its action attracts all types of fish. And here's where to get yours.
At your favorite fishing tackle outlet.
Atlanta Union Oil Dealers have free tickets to the Braves-Georgia Tech game at the stadium April 5th. Get free Braves tickets at Union Oil Dealers.
It takes more than a carpenter to build a house and more than a bricklayer. It takes good, solid financial planning. United States Savings Bonds should be part of those plans. For a house. For a home.
Of an evening, over a couple of martinis, we chit-chat about the day's work.
You mean to tell me that you know Dr. Sirkin's formula?
To the last decimal place.
We gotta take you to the captain right away.
Why?
Why? You hold the future of the entire missile program right in your bill, that's why.
So?
So? Don't you have any patriotism? Don't you have any feeling for your country?
Whose country? I'm a Canadian.
Everything's Ducky, Sunday afternoon at 4:00.